because they're all arid.
They don't smell of anything. Now, sometimes there's an interesting smell to the ink on a checkbook. But by and large, all this figuring is a completely colorless occupation. I don't like it. So I have to hand it over to accountants, lawyers, the people who seem to like it. But I don't know whether they really do. Some way in which you get paid for playing. When I was quite young, I forget exactly, I made a solemn which was that I would never accept it. I would always be my own employer. By and large, almost everybody seems to be compelled to take a job with a corporation. It's very difficult indeed these days to run a small business where you're your own boss, because you have to employ an enormous staff of people to keep track of the paperwork. I know a person, for example, who has a farm where he raises avocados. And the Department of Commerce visited him with a stack of forms this thick, which he had to fill in. Well, he got some. He said, "I have the faintest idea what to fill in these forms." He said to the agent of the Department of Commerce, "You fill them." And he made that man sit down and go through the whole procedure of filling in these forms. Because he said, "I don't have the time. I'm raising avocados. As for all this paperwork, to hell with it." And the same situation prevails not only in business, but also in the university. All the hospitals.
One of my favorite doctors told me the other day that he spends only one third of his working hours practicing medicine. The rest is in recording, accounting, filling in reports. It's the same in every hospital. Paperwork ends because the record of what you do is more important than what you do. Write it down and then it's real. So for the same reason, a lot of people don't believe they exist until they see their activities reported. A lot of juvenile delinquents commit crimes just to get attention. They'll get recorded. It's like you go to a party, you know, picnic on the beach, and it's great fun. And somebody says, "What a shame it is that nobody has a camera." Well, now, I should talk, because at this moment, we are recording what's going on, both on tape record and on TV. And remember, to do it. Now, who's going to listen to all this over and over again? So there's something fundamentally wrong here, and which the businessman of all people needs to understand. What the businessman needs to know equally, what the army officer needs to know. I've proposed that we have a kind of college entrance exam in which, instead of answering all the simple questions, you write about your life, 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 Now let's take the war in Vietnam. What on earth was it all about? If we had gone with military pomp and might into Vietnam for the express purpose of conquering the country and possessing it and carrying off the women into captivity, it would have been understandable. But as it was, it was waged for some absolutely abstract end, namely the stoppage of an ideology called communism. Nobody knows what communism is, nor do we know what capitalism is. But we can fight endlessly on the supposition that there are good guys and bad guys. And when we fight on that supposition, there is no possibility of compromise or of gentlemen's agreement, as there is honor among thieves. We are all thieves, let's face it. There is a doctrine in the Jewish religion that when God created Adam, he put into him a spirit which is called the Yetzer Hara, and that means the wayward spirit, or what I call the element of irreducible rascality. And that is in us all. A little bit. It's not the whole of us. Just a pinch of salt in the stew. And you don't want the whole stew to be salt. But you have to have just a touch of rascality. And I find it difficult to get along with people who don't know the world. People who come on the world all sincere, all good, all pure, warm in the bed, and scare me. They're unconscious in themselves, and therefore they suddenly do terrible things without warning, even to themselves or the others. They make promises that they're never going to fulfill because they want to talk right. And so, if I do business with someone who is not really aware of what he's about, I know he is impossible to do business with. He is suddenly. If I'm aware that he's a bit of a shyster, I feel comfortable. And I let him know that I am. Then we're human. Then we can let our hair down. Then we can say, look, let's work this out. And it's so this is what I want. And I know what you want. And if we can get that clear, we can work out the reason. A little play, different. If you don't have it, you're an absolute mistake. Now look at it this way. You can't operate business nowadays without a whole team of lawyers. And what is the function of lawyers? They're to write down the rules of the game. What is called the rule of law. Not just talk today about law and order. And how it's got to be upheld. Now what does that actually mean? It means that all organizations and business corporations, bureaucratic and government corporations, they are operating in the form of this doesn't work. It means that an organization. Thank you.
not how you do it. Unless you put in stuff on the level. Because your brain can an unknown number of variables, a variable digestive system, and so on and so on. Now, you operate those all day without knowing how you do it. There's no book of rules according to which you do this. So in the same way, if a corporation is to be a true organism as distinct from an organization, it must be based on the principle of mutual trust and not on law. Because if you can't trust other people, you cannot have a community, not even a corporation. It's risky, very risky to trust other people. Because they may let you down. But on the whole, if you do trust them, the chances are perhaps, 60 to 40, maybe a little more, maybe 75 to 25, that the system will work. Simply because they're trusting. And as soon as you've got a system where, for example, in a supermarket, there are mirrors all over the place, TV cameras watching everything, all kinds of checks on the cashiers, and they won't sneak off. You've got a system that increasingly won't work. Because nobody will want to work there. One of the major reasons for hippies and dropouts is that human beings don't want to work on things like that. Because they are mechanics. And the mechanism is quite distinct from the organism. Because the mechanism is arranged on linear plans. The book. Whereas the organism transcends them. We don't know how. That means we can't write down how. Because it's more complicated. So this is something that has to be recognized as a principle. Now let me give another illustration. Every corporation employs a number of people in research. Let's take IBM. They have a huge center down near San Jose where they have a research staff. One of the first things they had to I don't know. Paul said that the laborer is worthy of his hire. And I, as a philosopher, a mere philosopher, do you really want these? Or is it just that you've been reading ads in the magazine or listening to the other children? Because it's a school place and you send your child to be brought up by other children. And therefore they get a kind of lowest common denominator of culture. They all think they've got to have this.